you, Julie. All right, we're bringing in the home stretch, but we've got a great panel here and a lot of distinguished panelists. So I'd love for them to introduce themselves because I couldn't do it justice. So why don't we start on the far end with Cédric?
Yeah. Hi, thank you very much for inviting me. I'm Cédric Hutchings. I'm the co-founder of Withings, now part of Nokia, and now VP of Digital Health Activity at Nokia.
Sure. My name is Mike Stashak. I've been with Wahoo Fitness 6 years since the inception of it. Right now, my current position is corporate development strategy and business insights.
My name is Liz Dickinson. I'm the CEO and founder of Mio. We are one of the world's preeminent suppliers of heart rate monitoring technologies. And
Great. My name is James Lowe. I'm head of communications for Lifespan. We make functional products to enhance the health and wellness of people across atmospheres.
Define functional products.
That's a little vague, you're right. We're known for treadmill desks.
Okay.
We actually manufacture the bike desks that are in the back of the room, basically adding functional movement to otherwise sedentary atmospheres.
Great. So we got some names up here that people should be familiar with and a rich product portfolio across the group here, but maybe again, just to ground the audience, can you just talk about what's a new or more recent product that you've launched? Maybe you got something you launched here at CES or something at the end of last year, and then tell a little bit more about, kind of what's on the horizon that you guys are working on from a product perspective.
Okay. I'll pick up where I left off. As I said, we're known specifically for treadmill desks. This year we launched the Unity bike desk. It's at the back of the hall. We have found that motion is as unique as the person completing it, and that both atmospheres and the people that embody them are specific. So something might not be perfectly appropriate for every space. So in the case of pedaling, that's something that we're really exploring now. It's quiet, it's power-free, and it's really accessible. It's in no way biased. So. That's something that we're looking forward to. But culturally, I think we're really moving towards making it more acceptable to embrace health in business atmospheres, in the home, and incorporating it into activities that are otherwise stationary.
Okay. Liz?
So as I mentioned, Mio has a strong history in continuous heart rate. We actually were the first to release a product that took heart rate continuously from the wrist. We did that in 2012, and you can see what's happened in the industry since we've done that. The problem is that most people don't really understand how to engage with that information about their heart rate that they get from their monitor. So it's been really very vital for athletes in training, and even only about 15% of athletes utilize heart rate monitoring. So there's still a huge growth curve available for the richness of the data that comes from understanding heart rate. So what we've done as a company is take a step back and think about how can we make heart rate more meaningful to the everyday consumer. And so as a result, this year we're releasing at CES our product called Slice, which incorporates a new metric into it. It's not a metric that we made up or dreamed up ourselves. It's actually a metric called personal activity intelligence that was validated and created by the Norwegian University of Science and Technology, their Nobel Prize winning Faculty of Medicine. And it was based on the largest epidemiological study ever undertaken, over 60,000 people over 20 years. And it also included mortality in that database. And from that huge study, they were able to find out the exact amount of activity that specific individuals need, or individualized to each person, how much exercise a person needs to optimize their lifespan, potentially increasing it by up to 10 years. Super powerful, powerful science. So we've incorporated Pi into our Slice device, and we're actually making Pi available to other wearable companies that are interested in introducing it into their devices as well. We'd really like to see Pi become a global standard because it has such huge life-saving potential.
Mike.
So Wahoo got its start connecting fitness activities to the smartphone, specifically to the iPhone. And over the last 5 years, we've manifested that into cycling products, running products, heart rate products, et cetera. The big horizon left for us is the black hole of gyms. It's very difficult to go into a gym, do a workout, whether it's strength, whether it's cardio, whether it's functional training, and then leave that gym with your data. So our big push over the last year, and we'll continue this year, is how we can work with the OEMs, gym companies, and app partners to make a gym smart. And we're doing that by putting Wahoo devices across every type of gym equipment we possibly can.
So at Wizzing now at Nokia, we've been developing a range of connected health sensors ranging from sophisticated smart scale, blood pressure monitoring, sleep monitorings, with an obsession of developing the right user experience so that these devices are used on the long term. We strongly believe that to bring values, it requires to be sustainable in the everyday life of, quote, normal people. So people who do not have high motivation enough to accept too many trade-offs to get the benefits of all what we are talking about here. And our latest child that we announced, you know, here at CES is our Steel HR, which is the latest version of our analog face activity monitor watch that now embeds some similar technology that can assess continued heart rate monitoring. But still, sticking with what you know we stand for is superior convenience with a very long battery life of up to 25 days. You know, obviously waterproof, no touch of a button to read time. So really, this you know all day and night activity monitoring that fits for you know quote the rest of us.
Okay. Each of you has had product and market for several years now, right? You've continued to build a user base over that time. So compare and contrast the users when you first started. Who were they? Are they still using it? And then who is buying your products and using it today? What has evolved and what has changed over that time frame? Who'd like to start?
I'd love to tackle that because we actually started in the wearable business in 1999. Again, we created the world's first ECG-based watch that took your heart rate just by touching it. So if you've ever seen those devices where you have to touch them to get your heart rate, we were the first to actually monetize, commercialize those. And we found that the people that were engaging with those products, even though I created it as a weight loss product, a lifestyle product, the people that were engaging with those products were athletes, because the athletes themselves were the only ones that really understood how to use heart rate. And so essentially, our company had to pivot into products that really were meaningful for athletes, because that's who really understood our products. But it's interesting that since we've now been able to launch something like Pi, we're back into the lifestyle business again, and we're actually engaging with people in a conversation again about weight loss, which seems to be the primary motivator for people utilizing fitness devices.
I'd like to elaborate, and I think you know we had the same experience. We started commercializing our first scale in 2009. I will say that our first user were you know people looking for an accessory for their new cool smartphone. Let's be very clear: people passionate with what you know is possible with technology, and then obviously athletes and very health conscious people. And you know we had this term that now we know don't hear it anymore, but self quantifier. You know which was very popular 5 years ago. So you know people who really get about the measure, track, progress. So really looking for performance gears equipment. And I think that now what we've been seeing on the you know past couple of years and that we have in front of us is actually you know the rest of the people who you know interestingly enough will be most benefiting from all this technology because it's about how you shift just a little bit your lifestyle you know for a healthier lifestyle a bit more activity you know be more conscious about the correlation between your sleep quality you know some indicator of your heart health and risk but the paradox is that you know so far this population is still as our core user, and you know, I would guess that it's not our unique experience, it's still not our core user base. So what we have and what it demands is superior you know, convenience of use, user experience. Again, all the assets are now more and more, the expectation is going higher. You know, further we go down from you know, early geek and early adopters, health conscious athletes, and people who will benefit very much from our technology, but provided we do our job better and better of making it really true everyday life and lifestyle devices.
I won't reiterate what they said. I would agree with both what Liz and Cedric had said as well, but I think that the other dimension that I'll add to that is that over the last 5 years, you've seen the friction go down immensely, right? So the people 5 years ago were highly tolerant people that would spend 20 minutes before an exercise session or 20 minutes of their day trying to figure out device. Now you're seeing that because I think we've all done a great job of reducing that friction, you're seeing people that may not be, that, you know, were once technophobes are using these devices because they're so easy to use.
Yeah. And they appear less extreme though. Yeah. And maybe it's because they're more prolific, but I would imagine that a large percentage of this room has a wearable on. And if they don't, they're interested. For us, it was an interesting thing to see someone in 2012 walking on a treadmill desk. And it still might be a little bit off, you know, depending on your experience. But for us, it's much easier because it's become cultural, both inside of business and just person to person. And it's made inroads that I think are pretty impressive.
So most of the time, the consumption and the purchase of your products is derived from the individual, right? The consumer, the end user. But increasingly, and we've heard today, there are other sources and other entities that come into the arena to help purchase. It could be a corporation, it could be a healthcare organization, it could be an insurance company, sports organization, et cetera. How has that impacted how you market, how you position it, or are you guys still primarily focused on the end user and the consumer?
Well, for us, it was actually, the arc has been kind of interesting in that the talking point for us always used to start at outcomes. Now it was, you know, we can prove that we're going to reduce health concerns that will eventually reduce healthcare premiums. And that was the best way to get our foot in the door, you know, in B2B circumstances. Now though, I think people believe that it's effective because it is. It doesn't need a white paper behind it to validate its existence. And so it has kind of jumped past HR and into facilities. And if you have a head of culture or a head of employee experience, the conversation generally will start there instead of, you know, with somebody who's more outcome oriented.
Okay.
I mean, I think that this revolution over the last 5 years has been consumer led. I mean, you're now getting to a point, at least from our world, where you have consumers that are demanding better things from gyms, for example, right? So they walk into their gym and they're like, well, if I go for a run outside, I get every piece of data I need and I get all this great analytics and then I can go share all that data with my friends, put on Facebook, I walk into a gym and I leave with nothing. And so if you want me to continue to pay you $60 a month, you better do something for me beyond what you're doing today. So I think this consumer-led phenomenon is going into, you know, the interactions with gyms, it's going in the interactive with health providers, it's going in the interaction with you know, corporations, et cetera, and the consumers are demanding that they get more data from their daily interactions with other providers. That requires us to be better, not only consumer marketers, but it also requires us to have business-to-business skills as well, because the enterprise is a completely different business model than selling hundreds of thousands of widgets to people every year.
I absolutely agree that it's consumer-led because many, many years ago, we, you know, talked to companies trying to sell pedometers to employers, and they couldn't get employers to part with $2-3 or even less, you know, for a pedometer. And I think the fact that people are coming to the workplace already armed with their wearable has made it a lot easier for employers to figure out how can we now implement that into a program and utilize that in such a way that we can actuarially validate the activity levels that somebody's doing and the impact that that has on their longevity or their overall health. What's really cool about Pi, and I think it's going to make a huge mark in the employer wellness space, is because of the fact that it's scientifically validated and because you can actually see from an employee's usage of the activity, and it doesn't have to be steps, it can be playing with your grandchildren or, you know, walking the dog. Any activity counts. It doesn't have to be just walking. And that's why something like this is so powerful, because it allows employers to give freedom to their employees about what activities they choose to reward them, you know, with incentives.
Are you guys willing to share an example of a product initiative or something that you were headed down a path, but ultimately you canceled it, decided that's not for us, too hard to do, not going to work, et cetera. I'm curious what that is and if you could share that.
For us, it was the squat rack desk.
Oh.
Oh, there you go.
No, that didn't happen. We actually ran into an interesting issue regarding data. And it's weird because data is this thing that we're all craving. You know, we believe that we can derive really solid outcomes from it. But in the corporate space, data is also a liability. And so even if we are tracking weight and the evolution of weight with increased activity to, you know, provide some sort of benefit, weight is, in some, you know, circumstances, HIPAA-protected data. And so for us, it became a little bit less driven by providing data that was hard and dedicated to being more about experience and how is this, you know, functionally appropriate before it might be appropriate in an Excel spreadsheet.
Anyone else?
I mean, I'll
go ahead.
Fitness trackers. So 5 years ago, Fitbit, the original Fitbit came out. We said, oh, we can build a competitor to that. Oh, who wants a fitness tracker?
Yeah.
May have been a mistake, but no.
Yeah, years ago, 2009, we actually came up with a design for headphones with heart rate in them. Mm-hmm. And we thought, well, you know what? People actually only wear their headphones for maybe, you know, half an hour a day when they're exercising. Who the heck would want heart rate in their headphones? So we never did that. Mm-hmm. Wow.
Great, great. Okay. Apparel. You guys are all wrist-worn, other types of form factors. What do you think of apparels and sensors incorporated into that? How does that play into either your product portfolio or you think it's fundamentally a different kind of sector relative to kind of what you guys are up to?
I mean, I don't think we'll get into the apparel, but I would be bullish on the apparel. So 10 years ago, we have the same metrics as we had today. The only difference is that we can measure them today. So it's still calories, it's still miles, it's still the exact same metrics. But now we can have all these devices that can measure everything and we can, you know, then use that data in some ways better than others to make active changes to our life. The problem is that we're just now in sensor overload now. So the next 5 years, the next 10 years is all about even reducing the friction even more. Because you can't go for a run with four devices strapped to your body. You cannot go into a gym and have to get your, you know, car keys, your phone, your member key, your locker key, and a bunch of sensors in addition to that. So, you know, these sensors are going to have to be integrated into your daily life, right? And that could be clothes, that could be shoes, that could be, you know, the devices that you use. It could be, you know, chip implants under your skin. I mean, who knows? But I think that clothing will have to be part of the equation going forward just because we cannot put up with the sensor overload for that much longer.
The sensors will be ubiquitous. Yeah. I don't even think that's a question. Like when I hear people say things like wearables are dead, I think, what the heck? I mean, how can even somebody even say something that silly? Because we haven't even begun. I mean, we're in the era, like in when they first released the computer, it was massive, and the only thing we could think of as a use case was to store recipes on it. And you know, now it's the same situation with wearable technologies. Where the focus needs to be is in the analytics side of it, because the data is going to be coming in from all sources. And that's why we have actually decided as a company to put our money onto the predictive analytics, pulling in the data that's contextual, that is location-based, that's activity-based, and correlate that with your physiological data so they can actually give meaningful insights to people so they can change their behaviors, so they can know that if they did X, that they would feel better as a result of doing X, and remind them to do that.
So I will say yes to the question. We are obsessed of providing user experience, again, that's sustained, and so we don't have a philosophy on what's the right form factor. It's our issue as technologists to find it, you know, the best way to have it, you know, low profile and long term in our life. When we are interested in providing insight about, you know, sleep quality, you know, I believe, and you know, we are convinced that the only way to measure, you know, in the long term your sleep quality is by turning your bed into your sleep sensor. Mm-hmm. Nothing else. You know, it's not something on the long term for normal people that you would wear, you know, press a button or do anything. You know, same thing. I think wearable in a way, will disappear. So I will tend to disagree on the fact that we've been calling these devices by the name of wearable really as a kind of wannabe, you know, wishful thinking, which is, hey, wait a minute, this that provide me so many constraints is truly a wearable. I mean, yes, apparels are wearable. You know, a shirt is a wearable, a watch is a wearable, shoes are wearable, and the sensors will have to do a better job of making the sensors totally fit into that, because we do not turn ourselves. I don't think, again, that we do integrate long-term in our lives a routine of, I need to carry my sensor. Nobody wants to think about sensing anything. So it needs to be disappearing in apparel, in textile, or, you know. And again, sometimes it's where it has to be worn because it captures information about my motion. It has to be close to my skin because it gets signals, you know, through the screen with optical signals. But sometimes it can be a stationary device. And just as an example, we think that, you know, a scale, what's still called a weight scale, is actually a device that, you know, it's very common. It's in most of our bathroom. But what's interesting is the device, we step on it with a very natural gesture. And the challenge, and for us the passion, is how to capture this moment, to gather, you know, capture as much, you know, insight information without calling for any gesture. Now you step on our scale, you get a measure of your cardiovascular health, you know, which is your arterial stiffness, just by stepping on the scale. And I truly believe that, you know, it's our job to make it totally disappear in the right format of what we've been used for decades.
A couple years ago on panels like this, we would talk about the arrival of the Apple Watch, right? So now that it's come out, a couple versions have come out, what has changed for any of you? What have they done to the market, if anything? And where do you think that will take us?
Well, it's impacted our product strategy. I mean, if you think about it, there's, you know, millions and millions of Apple Watches out there. They're all sensors begging for a use case. And it's a brilliant product. We actually created a Pi app for the Apple Watch. So if you have an Apple Watch, in February you'll be able to download Pi and use it on your Apple Watch. That is the kind of use case, I think, that makes the Apple Watch meaningful. And really, it's, I think it's just beginning. I think it's a fantastic product.
There is something to be said, I believe, about user attention, though. At some point, I think people have so many things to keep their interest in that you get fatigued. And so I think centralization and open access of data is something that, when, you know, Google Fit and Apple Health kind of opened those doors for us, it made that process quite a bit easier. Because if I'm a MyFitnessPal user, if I am, you know, a proprietary app user, it's helpful, I think, to my user experience to lift the gates a little bit and have that, you know, aggregate into something that I can use without restriction.
So usually around the holidays, there's a spike in purchase of wearables and hardware-oriented devices in this category. You know, at some point, Q1, Q2, Q3, you know, they kind of go back in the drawer or aren't used as much. So what have each of you as product organizations done, maybe on the software side or otherwise, to drive continued engagement, retention, usage, and all that? And what has changed with kind of products and technologies today that allow you to do that you couldn't have done, you know, even a couple years ago?
With the proliferation of devices, I mean, basically it comes down to marketing 101, is that when in a brand new market, there's one segment and you just try to go for the big broad swathe of the market. As the market becomes more mature, you have to focus on a smaller and smaller segment. And so what, and you're seeing that, right? You're seeing, you know, companies that focus on just the athlete, and then just the athlete for cycling, or just the athlete for running. And that's what we've done. We've taken a very micro-focused approach to different segments and making sure that we're working to create, we're a consumer products company. You have to create raving fans, and you have to know your consumers extremely well for you to have continued growth. And so we've focused hard on cycling. We're focusing hard on the gym. We're focused on different subsegments under that so we can build relationships with those folks and build products that they will not just buy and put in the drawer, but they will buy and love and continue to use throughout the year.
I think it speaks to making products like wearables meaningful. And that's where we're really focusing, because it's become very clear that 10,000 steps is falling short, and consumers are getting very tired of the fact that, hey, I just did 10,000 steps and I actually haven't seen any change, you know, to my body or to my health. And people are looking for that thing that is actually meaningful, that will actually show some results and change something about their lives. And when we have crossed that barrier with wearable technologies, then I think we will have succeeded, and that's what we really should all be striving towards, making wearables meaningful.
Okay. Sitting here a year from now, what are we going to be talking about? What's your prediction?
I think it's in 17, so we'll see more and more, you know, integration of some of the technology we're talking about into healthcare. You know, in the past couple of years, we've been seeing so many pilots, you know, and for sure you can be, you know, dead a few times by pilots. But we've seen on certain segments, and I kind of, you know, resonate to this notion of focus on certain and condition. In our case, you know, some chronic condition like hypertension, CHF, stroke. It's now became very clear that, you know, there are values to build with these devices and be now integrated in clinical setups, you know, in remote management of this patient. And I think that we'll, you know, see in 17 large scale, in some case large scale usage of some of this technology in healthcare provider for the first time.
Yeah, I mean, I can't believe we haven't touched on consolidation yet. Mm-hmm. I mean, I do this panel every single year. I talk about consolidation. Yep. And, you know, we're still a fragmented industry. We still have, there will be consolidation. People will go out of business. I think that you saw a massive amount of consolidation, you know, in the last year, especially with big names getting into this. And I think it's going to continue throughout because I don't think there's going to be many new entrants anymore. I mean, I think it's really going to be about a consolidation and maturation play.
Liz?
I think we're going to be talking much more about AI and machine learning and predictive analytics and taking all of this data that's coming from all of these sensors and correlating it into meaningful value propositions for the consumer.
James?
I know what I hope for, and maybe that's easier to say than what I predict because it's so nebulous, but it seems like anything that's ever worth developing always has a thread straight back to what makes people human. And if a product doesn't resonate with what is foundationally human, I think it's set to fail. And so even if that means taking big data and making it relatable to a 15-year-old, you know, something that, oh, I connect with that because of a reason I don't even know, because it's that natural. That's what I hope we do.
Great.
And with any luck, we'll get there.
Great. Maybe if we have time for a couple questions from the audience, we'd love to take them.
Questions? You can raise your hand and I'll... Questions?
Not one hand?
I think the earthquake
hand?
Is scaring everybody.
Oh, here we got one. You got two.
Great.
All right.
Hi, Michael. So I spend a lot of time in the apps and gaming spaces, and in particular doing stuff with loyalty programs and gamification and integrating products. And a lot of these industries over the past 20 years have gone into a 2.0 phase where people came to the realization, to Liz's point, about creating meaning for consumers through external forces. Have you guys done any experiments with that? Have you had any successes that you'd like to talk about where you said, you know what, we're going to do something where you take these points, kind of like with the United Healthcare people earlier, where they said, look, you can make $4 a day just by getting off your butt and going out and doing some walking. Have you found anything that you've done where you've created value through a third party via an integrated platform or something similar to make it more meaningful beyond just the activity, to give them some kind of a reward? Because that seems to be the genesis of like a 2.0 industry for everything. And I haven't heard the term fitness 2.0 because I'm kind of new to the room, but is that what your fitness 2.0 era is going to look like? And have you guys tried anything to make that happen?
We did fitness 2.0 3 years ago, didn't we, guys? I think we're at four.
So I think to paraphrase the question, like any gamification, any other loyalty, any kind of the trademark product tactics that you see in gaming, you know, kind of have they been ported into this space or have been tried here? Why or why not?
You're seeing it. I mean, at least in our world, there's the cycling world. About 18 months ago, they launched a massive multiplayer game called Zwift, and it allows you to jump on one of our trainers. The game controls the resistance in the trainer to match the elevation profile of the game, and I can ride with 2,000 of my friends around the world who are all live in this virtual world. And let me tell you, as a cyclist, nothing is worse than sitting in a room on a trainer going nowhere, right? Riding with Zwift is one of the top, you know, is a phenomenal cycling experience, right? So it goes to prove your point that if you can entertain, if you can motivate someone, if you can get them incentivized, get off the couch through some emotional play or something that makes it fun, makes it engaging, that's what's gonna happen. And you still see, sorry, Liz, I know you're gonna jump into this, but you still see one of the most successful fitness companies on the planet is Beachbody, right? And those are entertaining videos of P90X, Insanity Max 30, right? And that is what is driving people to get fit. And because it's entertaining, because it's new content every day, and you know, I would say that as we go forward, in order for you to be motivated and entertained, back to your question, it's going to be content. It could be gamification, it could be something other entertaining, but the content play is just still not there in the health and fitness world.
Yeah, I think it's actually a really complicated subject. Human motivation is so individual, and I think you have to develop something that's, you know, will resonate with every individual at a personal level. And that's what is so important about Pi, and is what is making it so interesting, is because it's based upon you as an individual. When you start using Pi, if you're not very fit, it isn't hard for you to achieve 100 Pi, so you don't get discouraged. If you're already fit, it takes that into consideration, and then the amount of activity you have to do is a lot more strenuous and harder because of the the risk category or the classification that you're in. I think the answer is very much about getting the information and the data about the individual and personalizing whatever, you know, content or motivational tactic or delivering, you know, anything that you deliver to that individual, it all has to be very personalized to be effective. And that's where AI and big data is going to make a huge difference in the future.
All right.
We have one more question.
Okay.
Right here. Thanks. Great panel, by the way. My name is Pamela Kiernan, and I have a wearable technology apparel company. So this is kind of the question I've been waiting to ask all day. It's about impending and coming sensor technology, because we've talked a lot about today and really for the last years about what's coming off the wrist. The wrist is where we've lived for like the last 5 to 6 years, but everybody's talking about getting off the wrist. So my question to the panel is, in your work, what kind of sensing technologies and sensors are you seeing that may not be here today, but what are they solving for on the body, and when do you think that you'll see them in the marketplace?
Well, we introduced a product here that can be plugged into apparel. You can wear it on your wrist, you can wear it up here, very flexible. We can take information from any part on the body, and once you get a PPG wave, you can extract from it, or at least we can, heart rate variability, which is a measure of stress, respiration, oxygenation, blood pressure. You can do a lot with that signal itself. So, you know, from our perspective, the things that are gonna go into other form factors are going to be constrained by battery. That's the gating technology still for everybody. Once we figure that out, the game will change radically.
I'd only add that we're talking about most things that are on body. I think the game changes if you're willing to go invasive, right? So unfortunately,
the battery issue.
Right. Well, the fallacy of a Theranos or something else like that, you know. But I mean, we're still playing with the same types of things on the outside. But if you can actually draw blood on a frequent basis, that's going to change the game in terms of what you can tell about physiology, et cetera. But it's a different space.
That's great. Join me in thanking our panel. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Liz. Thank you, James. Thank you.